Oh, hi everyone. Welcome to the fifth episode of the Game to Change podcast. Ara is not with us right now. She's currently in Japan. To balance out the testosterone, we have our dear friend Mikki here.
Hi.
Hi. And once again, we're joined by Leaf.
Oh, hi.
And
I'm here.
He still does not have a camera. We actually need you guys to subscribe, like, comment, and share so he can afford one.
or he'll be forced to get one.
Mm-hmm. Or sponsor me.
Or your fans will need to know what you look like.
Yeah, Leaf, there's a demand for your face.
Yeah.
Sponsor me so I can get my webcam.
So this is our first podcast this month, and like the previous month, we do have the giveaway at the end of the month, and I'm changing it up a bit. Instead of the $50 PSN card, it would be $50 of anything. You can choose to have it be Steam codes. I think Blizzard credits is an option. E-store wallet. Is there 50 for
this? Can it be like Google Play codes too?
Sure. Google Play codes. So
yeah,
it's
Google
50
Play
of a thing. Your choice.
Wow.
So to be yes.
Yeah.
to be part of the raffle, all you need to do is be a subscriber and comment on the videos, all of the videos on the channel that will come out this month, and we will announce the winner for that on the live episode at the end of the month. Okay, so that would be the 30th of July. So let's start. We always start with what we've been playing, and guys, have you played anything this week? Leaf?
Yeah.
Okay, Mikki.
Ladies first.
Okay, me first. I just got my PC back from the dead, so I'm gonna play a lot of PC games. Mm-hmm. Yes, thank you. Thank you so much. I've tried to play Pokemon Go when it was like available for a very short time. And I was so hyped about it, but now we can't play it, so I'm still waiting.
How far did you get with Pokemon Go?
I was still like level 2, because I live in the middle of nowhere.
Yeah.
So I can't see anything.
What was your starter?
Because I'm lazy, I picked the nearest Pokemon from where I spawned.
Uh-huh.
So it was Bulbasaur.
Okay.
You have to walk to it. So yeah. Some people think that they captured Bulbasaur, but actually it's just like every single Pokemon game where the three starters are spawned and you get to pick one.
Mm-hmm.
But you have to walk towards it,
yeah,
right? And
yeah.
they spawn in like different locations. The coolest one, of course, just Charmander, is located furthest from you. So I was like, whatever, Charmander, you're not near me. I'm not going where you are.
It was the same for me, where Bulbasaur was the one. I was in bed. I just got off work. I was very tired. Bulbasaur was right next to me. It's like, you my starter now. How about you leave
the
game?
Everyone's gonna get a Bulbasaur.
How about you leave? Did you try Pokemon Go?
No, Intel CPUs are not supported, so I can play it. Want to do. Yeah.
I have an extra phone.
Oh,
might support.
The reason why they don't allow Intel CPUs is because the Intel CPUs heat up easily.
Oh.
So you use GPS and your data.
Mm-hmm.
With an Intel CPU, it might explode. So better safe than sorry. They just didn't allow Intel CPUs to use it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Oh well.
Oh yeah. So another game I've Monster Hunter X. And I know I've told people, and yeah. I told people I will not play this game because their females look like males to me in the previous games. Mm-hmm. But this demo has an archer girl that looks like a girl. So I was like, okay, this is it. I'm playing this game. And you, on this demo, you can be a cat. So oh, yeah. I've been running around being
a cat.
Yeah. Have you guys tried it?
I downloaded it, but didn't play it because I had no one to play with. My schedule was different from everyone else. I'm now a morning person.
Aww. Let's play it together then.
Okay. My DS needs to recharge though. I'll bring it later.
Yeah. Cool. Okay. You leave.
Yeah, I think I downloaded it and I played with a few people like Keigo and Sandy, but yeah. It's cool. I wasn't used to the Monster Hunter formula. It has its unique playstyle, so I haven't been used to it, so it takes a while for me.
You really enjoyed the Final Fantasy one, Explorers. When we were playing, you heard Dave and I complained about how simplistic Explorers was compared to Monster Hunter. Did you see the difference in the game?
Yeah, the difficulty is much more than it was in Final Fantasy.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah, it gets a little being used to.
Since you played more than Leaf Mick, which do you find more enjoyable? Not better, enjoyable.
I can't say for Monster Hunter yet because I only played the demo.
Mm-hmm.
Enjoyable. In terms of it being enjoyable, I certainly enjoyed Final Fantasy because it had mages.
Okay, yeah.
That's the one thing Monster Hunter will probably never have.
Yeah,
mages.
Yeah,
I agree. So they don't have that. And one thing that Final Fantasy also had was the ability to mix and match your builds. Mm-hmm. I don't think Monster Hunter will have that because each ability you have is tied to your weapon.
You can't mix, but you can jump between weapon classes.
Yeah, that's true. So I remember when I first started playing Final Fantasy,
mm-hmm.
there's this freelancer class where mm-hmm. you can technically be everything, but not very good at it. Mm-hmm. So I was like, this is the best class in game. It's just very hard to get, but, you know, the theory crafter in you mm-hmm. kind of gets you going. What else? But the thing is, with Monster Hunter, it's very difficult. And once you finish a monster, mm-hmm. it takes like 25 minutes to just kill one guy, right?
Yes.
Once you finish that guy, it feels so good. So mm-hmm. I guess that's one thing that Monster Hunter has over Final Fantasy. The whole, I can finally kill this guy.
Now that you've enjoyed Monster Hunter, are you willing to try Dark Souls?
Why?
Continue the Mikitchi place.
That game is pure torture. I can't even play Zombie Parkour game, whatever the title was.
Dying Light.
What's the title? Yeah, Dying Light. I can't even play that game.
Did I return it?
If I finish Dying Light, I probably will.
But Dark Souls is easier than Dying Light.
How dare you say that?
I would agree.
Come on. Do you guys remember I threw firecrackers at cars? So no.
Exactly. See, the problem with Dying Light is you need to be aware of your environment in a 3D space. It's not only X, Y, you also have to think about Z, the verticality of things. Whereas Dark Souls, you only have to move in the 3D, in a 3D space. In the ground.
I think somebody gifted me Dying Light, and I never accepted the gift, but I have to check. Do kids expire?
What?
I don't. Do Steam gifts expire?
No. I'm not sure.
No, but I think it was Narcissus. I don't know.
You can decline it.
Maybe.
I'm not sure about expire, but
wanna,
you can decline.
I don't wanna check it.
Okay.
It just sits there forever. Whatever. Let's go.
How about you, Lee?
I'm playing Punch Club right now.
Punch.
It's a
Punch
Club. Yeah, the boxing simulation game.
Uh huh.
Yeah, I've been addicted to it for a while. Been playing for 8 hours already. It's cool. It's a boxing simulation game. Like you start, with very minimal stats, and then you have to like train and stuff, fight. People fight in a boxing club arena stuff. It's fun. It's kind of like an idle game because you basically don't do anything when a boxing match happens.
Uh-huh.
You just wait for it to end, and you just input some skills.
Mm.
It's interesting. It has a story too. So
where are you playing it?
On PC.
On PC.
It's a Steam game.
Okay.
Yeah, I got it from the sale. Someone gifted it for me.
Oh, okay.
It was 80 pesos.
You lucky bastard.
Nice.
I heard
pretty.
About
that's
Punch
the
Club.
Most important question. I'm gonna
yeah.
Look at it's not pretty.
It's
totally boring.
It's
huh?
Retro style. It's retro style. Game.
Depends on what you say pretty.
You know what I mean by
pretty.
Oh,
yeah.
Pretty.
Then no.
What's the name? Punch?
Punch Club.
Punch Club.
I found it. One player, that's Punch, though. It's fun.
It has very good visuals. And colorful.
Yeah. I'm
it's
looking
like
at
an
it
artwork.
Right now. Nah, it's pretty okay.
But not pretty.
It's very boy. If
it's
that's
very,
what you're asking.
It's boy,
it's
yeah.
Very boy. Yes.
Yes.
As for me, I this week the highlight of the week was me getting the backer demo for Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night. Do you know Bloodstained?
Not sure. Let me check.
It's the Castlevania thing, right?
Yeah, it's the Castlevania thing. So.
Okay.
Bloodstained: Ritual of the Night is the Kickstarter game from, I can't pronounce it, Koji Igarashi, the guy who created Castlevania. And then
oh yes, I remember this game.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And then
I remember
it. So they released a short demo. It's set in the ship Minerva. Though you don't, the only way to know that is to read the Kickstarter page and. It really, really feels like a Castlevania game from the floating, the floating animation, the attacks, the map, the way the map is presented, and it is using the skill system from the DS Castlevanias, Aria of Sorrow and Dissonance of Sorrow, the one with the Japanese protagonist Soma. So that the skill system there is that you kill a lot of creatures, and then if you kill enough, randomly get their essence, and you will be able to do a skill that they do. And in the game, it has five classes of skills. I was only able to get two. So one that's projectile, and the other one is aimed skill. It's really nice. If you've been waiting for a Castlevania game and really hated the recent one, the Mirrors of Fate, I think, the one, then this game is gonna be what you're looking for.
It's still Kickstarter though. So they can't buy it until it comes out?
Not yet. And the demo is for the people who backed it for $60. I was asked if you can back it now and get the demo, but I'm not sure.
Okay.
You think it's not good enough to be backed up?
Or, it's already fully funded. Oh. It's just in production.
Okay.
It's been like around the internet for like months now. I think I came across that too somewhere.
Yeah,
it's like, oh, this game is not for me though, but I've seen it around.
Mm-hmm. I really like Castlevania games. I like Symphony of the Night, and then the Game Boy. Most of my Game Boy games were Castlevania titles, and then I just like 2D action platformers and stuff, and then the appeal to Castlevania for most people is the backtracking, because there are areas you can't reach until you get a specific skill, and then it's part of the appeal. It's kind of why I like it, but a lot of people like the mechanics itself because it's very solid. Anything else we've been playing?
I think that's it.
Really?
League of Legends, always.
I haven't had a chance to play with you guys this week with League of Legends. By the time
we could. I just reinstalled all my games today. So we could play that game.
Because our schedule.
Or.
Okay.
I have a better idea. Why don't we play Don't Starve?
Together?
Yes. I think that game's awesome. Or, no. You know what? Let's just play Overwatch. Come on.
At least can play Overwatch.
Yeah, I can.
Yes, you can.
It's fine.
We'll make it happen. I'll make it happen.
BDO will find ways.
Yes.
Mick, since you played Monster Hunter and Leaf and I are gonna play it, why not play Evolve?
Yeah, Evolve is good.
You can have a doggy.
You know what?
You can name it Camel.
I will. Fuck you. I'll try to download it if I have. Yeah, I'll try to download it later, and just like all the other rules in every single game I play, I will play 4 hours of it, and if I don't like it, I will uninstall. Deal?
Deal. Leaf, do you have Guns of Icarus?
Say no.
Leaf, do you have Guns of Icarus?
No, I don't.
Because I have two codes. Shut up. I have two codes which we can use. We can use to play. Why do you hate the game?
That's his dream. He's been asking us to play that game for, I think, a year and a half now, and no one has
the time. No one has the game. Now that I got two codes for it, no one wants
to. Or just the game.
Huh? No one wants to install it.
Explain what it is.
So the game.
No, explain what the game is about.
Think of a steampunk world where aerial battles are what determines the course of history. And you are part of the navy. So each ship is manned by 4 people. And we are that people, and most scenarios are 2v2. So you and another ship fight two ships, and your primary contacts are that of your ship alone, so you kind of need to guess what the other ship is guessing while maintaining your ship and trying to kill as many the bad guys as much as possible, because it's a race to 5.
So it's like playing Star Wars.
Star Trek.
And you... No, let's use Star Wars because it's more popular.
Okay.
So it's like playing Star Wars with another team, and then you fight the enemy while you're all fighting within your ship because you have no idea what you're doing. Something like that. I don't know how to feel.
So it's like this: you have a captain, right, for ship. He controls where the ship goes, how high it gets, how low, and he technically takes command. I don't want to be the captain. I want Lutz to be the captain. And that person will, and then the rest of us will man the ship. We board the gunners, we repair the ship, and we spot other people. So it's a really cooperative, competitive game, which I love.
So Leif, are you convinced? Are you convinced to risk your butt for this guy and, you know, fight with him because gahi ulo?
And it's
gonna be a janitor position on the game.
Yes, there is. It's called the engineer.
No.
So it's gonna be recorded.
No.
Why not?
Do you know this indie game? There's this indie game called Faster Than Light, right? And it's this 2D game. It's very simple, and you basically own the ship,
simple
and you
concept.
Man everyone inside it. Mm-hmm. We are technically robots in that ship. And then we just follow whatever the captain does.
No, we don't have to follow what the captain does. He just steers the ship. You can take command. If you don't like where Dutz is bringing us, we can shout at him.
I'm pretty sure I will just press random buttons. I'm pretty sure. And Leaf too will press random buttons. But yeah.
Or I will fall asleep somewhere in the middle of the game.
How about last time, right? How about we schedule that and see if we can finally play it?
No, oh yeah.
Okay.
On a Saturday.
On a Saturday, yes.
For this month, yeah.
For the next month. Yeah.
Yeah. Because I'm not sure about the schedules in the new game, so.
It's gonna be a very weird. It's still transitioning for most of us, so we don't know what our schedules are. Ara, when she gets back, she might have a very different schedule.
We'll see. If it will happen, it will happen.
Yeah.
We really haven't played much of anything. I tried Fury, the free game from PS Plus. Have you tried it, Leaf?
No, I haven't yet. No. No, I think I have it downloaded.
I played it very briefly. The start. You start at a boss fight, and for some reason the way the game does boss fights, or from what I've seen so far, is that it's stages. So you have your life, right? And beneath that life, there are not a lot of blocks. So it's like the checkpoint. So when you fight someone, you reduce their life, it removes a box. It's similar to how bosses were in Dragon Dogma, if any of you remember. There was this little nodes on the bottom of their life. The problem with Fury is that you have the same nodes, and when your life diminishes and a node is removed, the opponent's life replenishes within the same node. So you almost get him. You almost kill him for that node, and you die. Then you have to start over again. I was not able to finish that part because I needed to sleep. But
oh, sleep.
Yeah, it was like 10 in the evening and I needed to wake up at 3.
Don't you wish you were a robot so that you don't have to sleep?
Or I wish I could assign my sleep to someone else. Like, oi, you sleep.
No. This is episode in Buffy the Vampire Slayer, and I know that makes me sound so old, but I think it was episode 3 or episode 4, where there's these nerds, right? And their monitors are still CRT, and they were apparently mind controlled by Buffy, the vampire that Buffy was trying to kill.
Mm-hmm.
And these nerds were like, we have to always be logged in. Like, you're not alive if you're not jacked in. That's like my favorite line of all time. Like, this guy knows the truth. This guy is my spirit animal. So I was like, we need to be robots.
Buffy, all of Buffy is on iFlix.
Cool. I don't have iFlix yet. How much do you pay for iFlix?
Since I disconnected, my PLDT is now 129. You should be 99, or you might get it for free. I'm not sure. I'll try asking.
That's not so bad, right? 129.
It's 99 for you. Yeah. I find that they have a better selection than Netflix. The only thing Netflix has are the Marvel stuff and House of Cards, and Orange is the New Black. But other than that, I would prefer iFlix. They also have Fresh Prince of Bel Air, which I've been watching a lot of.
iFlix has, how do you pronounce that? Ruby. R-W-B-Y.
Ruby.
Is that Ruby,
yeah.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
I think they have the whole series, which I have not watched, and I have second thoughts about watching because it was never finished.
I actually thought that was a machinima short, Ruby. It initially I thought it was one of the machinima stuff.
Yeah, because the guy who made it was into that sort of thing.
Oh,
what was his name?
I'm not familiar.
Isn't that an anime?
What?
It's an anime, right?
Yeah, it's
animation.
At first, I thought it was
technically animation. Okay.
Oh.
Yeah, it's made by Monty Ohm, who used to make a lot of videos, I think in 2008.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he took characters from Final Fantasy, and what was the other one?
I'm not
Dead or Alive, yeah, that's why. Dead or Alive, that's why he called it Dead Fantasy, and he had, like, nothing but action scenes for all the female characters.
Oh, I think
so,
I've seen some of those.
Yeah, it's called Dead Fantasy, and then I think that was his claim to fame, so it became super popular, and eventually it was said that he had the series going on, and they showed trailers. I remember being in the office screaming about, because what he did was he showed red,
mm-hmm,
and white and blue and
yellow,
which was the reason why that title is weird like that.
That's why,
and
I thought it was a short.
Yeah.
Because it started out
and then
as
eventually,
sorry. Go.
It's okay. But he died, so that's why it's like, what's the point of watching if the guy who made it died? But I think they have a game for it though, which I am very interested about. Because it looks
cool.
Yeah,
it's on Steam.
It's on Steam right now, right?
Yeah. I think they released 3 volumes of it, mm-hmm, but like, I'm not sure if the gameplay is for me. Probably for you. For the both of you. Because it's like fighting and stuff.
I have a lot of games to catch up on. I actually really wanted to play Elysian Tale this week, because a lot of people on the last podcast were very into it. I mean, they had nothing but high praise for the game. I have it on my PS4 right now. It's finally downloaded again, but I didn't have time.
Oh, time.
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
What else?
How about you, Leaf? Nothing else?
Must be it.
That's it.
Yeah, I think that's it.
Okay, let's head on to the news section. So, for news, let's touch on something we talked about last week. We talked about remasters and how we could not really identify the audience for Arkham Knight. I mean, we never understood why they were re-releasing it. But a few days after, or maybe the day of recording, they announced that Bioshock, the Bioshock remaster, is gonna be coming to the new generation of consoles. And a lot of people seem to say that they want to get it, and then you, Mickey, said that you might be interested since you've never played it before. And it's just a difference of reaction compared to the Batman games. What do you think is the reason behind that?
Well, if you think about it, we've had so many Batman movies in the past. We've had so many Batman games. So you kind of don't want to know more about Batman. What else is there to know about all the Batmans in the past, right? Whereas Bioshock is a totally different thing.
Uh-huh. Leave disconnected again. So, sorry.
It's alright. I know we had a deal. I will kill you.
Okay, he's back. He's back. He's back.
Welcome back, Lee.
This is kind of why we need at least four people, so that when one person disconnects, it won't blow up the face of the remaining person.
Shut up.
Lee, you
sorry.
I hate you.
That's not my fault.
So, I know. We still not friends, though. What was he saying? Oh, yeah. Bioshock. Bioshock is a totally different story, and you kind of want to know why it had so many like sequels.
Understandable. How about you, Lee? What do you think people reacted more about? Not saying that the reaction was negative for Batman. A lot of people do want it, but a lot of people were asking why bother, especially since it's on PC. Bioshock is the same, but the reactions were more favorable, at least amongst us. What do you think that?
Yeah, I think it is favorable for those who haven't played the game yet and they want to own it on the PS4.
Mm-hmm.
I would say Bioshock 3 was a very good game, a very interesting game for me. It's the only Bioshock I played, but it was very enjoyable because I like the mechanics. I like the story, the way it progressed. And the twists were just mind-blowing for me. So it's definitely a must game for you if you're interested in twists and plots like that, interesting stories like that. Yeah.
There are people who believe that simply mentioning that there's a twist already spoils the game.
Oh, man. Does it? I don't think
because
so, though.
Because some people expect it.
Mm-hmm. So there, is this a twist? I know how that feels. But it doesn't really, right? I mean, I've watched movies where they say this is a scary movie, and you will get scared. And when you watch the movie, you still get scared anyway. So it's not like it'll ruin anything.
Even for me with scary movies, I would say I've been watching scary movies for so long that I sometimes pinpoint where the jump scares are. I'm gonna say, oh, this is gonna happen here, and I'm right. But even
so, if I brace myself,
even if I'm prepared, I still jump up.
Yeah
sometimes
still
jump.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So I was just teasing.
So
me.
even with cats, remember the jump scare cat game that you wanted me to play?
Cat game. What jump scare?
Yeah, I remember. You know, it was a jump scare game that you gave me, I think.
It was not cat. It was a spooky
it was
house
my God,
of horror.
So I'm sorry. Yeah, whatever. I only remember cats and jump scares.
Okay.
I didn't play it because you were like, this is a jump scare game. Go play it. So I didn't play it.
Play it on video.
You're not very convincing.
For me, I think it's because the games were very different. When you think Batman, the mechanics rarely change. For the collection, the most significant change is, the changes were from 1 to 2 is environment, where 1 was in Arkham only, and then 2 it became open world, but everything else remained the same. For 3, for Arkham Knight, they added a car.
Arkham Origins first.
Is Arkham Origins part of the collection? I thought it was only Rocksteady, the Rocksteady games. But if we're gonna include Arkham Origins, then they change how boss battles work, but in a boring way. And then with Arkham Knight, they added a car, which some people did not like at all. They liked the idea of the car. It was just the Batmobile. But it was just
too much. But girls like cars. You need to give Batman a car.
Yeah, I think in Arkham Knight, like, they incorporated the Batmobile too much in all the gameplay. So it's like they're selling the car, but not the game.
So the reason why more people are interested in the Bioshock Remastered for me is compared to what Arkham did, where the small changes, the Bioshock games changed drastically. Bioshock 1 was a action horror game. The setting was very bleak. The world was amazing, but the enemies you encountered were sort of freaky, and it was claustrophobic at some areas where you can feel the water crushing down on the city, and seeing the Big Daddy was very frightening. You argue against yourself if you want to level up or just stay alive, because the only way to power up in the game is to get mana or whatever that was from Atom from the little sisters, and they're protected by the Big Daddies. So if it's a very tense game. Bioshock 2, you were the Big Daddy, so you did not fear the enemies as much. And then they also changed the shooting mechanic, where now in Bioshock 1, you either chose your weapon or your power. In Bioshock 2, with a different developer, you can now wield both. And then with Infinite, the one people are more aware of, they turned the game into something more vibrant. People have said that it sometimes looks like a Disney Pixar game. The NPC Elizabeth is incredibly animated, so much so that she gets compared to a Disney princess. It's just it's incredibly different. And then the setting has all changed. So each game brings you something new in a drastic way, whereas the Arkham Collection only had very small changes between titles.
Yeah, I would agree.
Like, I mean, do you think that the game that the Batman guys wanted to make, the people who will play Batman, do you think they're okay with change? Like, are they more accepting to a different Batman versus the Bioshock community, were like, oh yeah, we're okay with you changing the mechanics, we're okay with you changing the world, because we're that kind of people? Because I'm pretty sure Batman fans are like, this is Batman, this is how we want the game to be.
That is,
right? I think
you're right, because when Arkham, sorry, leave you first.
Yeah. Oh well, okay. I think with Batman games, it's not about the mechanics, it's about the villains that you encounter, because people are more interested in who they get to fight than changing the mechanics of the game, I think. Mm-hmm. And in just introducing the little things like the Batmobile or upgrades to his weapons, it gives you more interested in the story than the gameplay. I think that's what.
With that in mind, they kind of painted themselves in the corner with Arkham City, right? Because if you think Batman, the villain you'd want the most would be Joker. And spoilers, they kind of removed him from the equation with Arkham City.
That's true.
I didn't play Arkham Knight. Did you feel that the reveal or the villain of that game was satisfactory?
Not really. I think I forgot about him. Because he was not really the main villain. It was still Scarecrow. And I think
Scarecrow is the scariest. I agree.
Yeah, Scarecrow works for Batman games.
Mm-hmm. Oh, because
it gives a lot of things.
did you remember the first time you encountered a Scarecrow illusion in Arkham Asylum?
Yeah, yes.
It was like the worst, the worst villain I think in all Batman games is Scarecrow.
It really works
because of the like you think the game was broken.
Yeah. Like what is Scarecrow?
Yeah, they played that one well. Mm. So I think that's the problem of the franchise itself, because Batman has created its own world for how many generations, aside from the movies, aside from the comic. So the game has really little to work with when it comes to like freedom, because this is how the people who will consume this game want the game to be. Mm-hmm. Whereas Bioshock, it's its own world. You, as the game developer, can do anything you want, which is why me, as somebody who has never played any Bioshock game, I wanna know it from the beginning, which is why the Bioshock Remastered is great, which is why I wanna play it, because I don't have to play it in like really old, clunky, like graphics, right? Yeah. You can play it in like much better setting.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that's what I think about it.
Okay.
Yeah, I agree. Like, I think in Batman games, you can jump into any other version of the game. Whereas in Bioshock, you might want to like go into each of the game to understand it, since it gives a different mechanic each time. So I agree.
I also have to blame the industry as a whole for why Batman is not, even though it's popular, it's getting old, because Batman created a very seamless and free flowing combat system which a lot of developers followed. Even one of my favorite games of last year, I think, Shadow of Mordor, technically took the Arkham fighting system and implemented it into their game. So when you play a new Batman game, it does not feel new, because in between releases, there has been games where that has used similar mechanics.
Yeah, even Mad Max like adopted that,
but not properly, right? It's a little bit clunkier with Mad Max. I think it's gone. Oh, he's here.
He's still there. Why do you kill him off so quickly?
Okay, so that's it was supposed to be a very short touch on Remastered, but we got a very great conversation out of it. Next up would be news. So the visual novel, the puzzle adventure of the series 999 is finally coming to PC. Originally DS titles, and they've had, I think, two on the Vita, which the first one I played, I didn't play to completion because I suck at puzzles, but it was fun while it lasted. I know Leaf completed it 100% with all alternate timelines. And then Mikitchi.
You got to the true ending, Lee?
Yeah, I did. It was good.
And as for Mikitchi, this series has been on your radar for quite some time, right?
Yes.
I know that you're a DS primary player, but you're very busy on your DS. Wow. Yes. Do you think you'd play it on the PC instead?
The thing here is, I noticed in the past year, a lot of games for the visual novel games that I really, really love, that were from every single platform, like let's say Vita or like the DS, has finally been gone to PC. And I really like that, because a lot of people who can barely afford console games can afford a PC. So what this means is more visual novels from Japan or from everywhere else in the world can finally get translated into English, and more games of that sort will come out. So it makes me very happy that they're finally porting it to PC.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll probably just buy it just to support it so that more games like it will come out.
Also, PC has more sales, So yes, we might get it cheaper. Because cartridge prices don't really go down that much. I think the cheapest would be 900 something. Am I right?
995.
About $20.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I remember, I have to admit, I pirated the original 999 because I couldn't find it here in Cebu.
It was on the DSi, right?
It was on the DS. It was on the DS, and that game wasn't available here. So I pirated it, and I remember laughing to myself because the main guy in the first ever of the franchise, his name is Junpei, and I told Junpei, "Hey, you're in my game," and yeah, so you begin with 999 because I bought eventually, so I pirated it, and eventually I found it. Mm-hmm. I found it in SM, so I was so happy, and I bought it anyway, even if I finished it already. It's a very good puzzle game. Did you play it, Leaf? The original one?
I haven't played 999. I only played The Last Reward.
I
wish I could play the 999.
I have 999. It's really good. It is very good.
I mean, the series is good.
You will know the origin story of the main character. Of the reason why you were, so let me just give a summary of the whole series.
I'll put up the spoiler warning. Just wait. Okay, go.
Okay, so it's a summary, right? So the game is all about you being Junpei, and even if it's supposed to be pronounced Junpei, I will say it Junpei.
Yeah.
You are transported into this ship, and you have no idea what you're doing there. Mm-hmm. You are told to play a game. And in order to escape, you need to get 9 points so you can escape free. If you go to 0, you are killed. Mm-hmm. So it's like all the other games, like Liar Game or Danganronpa, where you have to talk with your teammates, find a way to escape. And if you played Virtue without playing 999, it kind of gets confusing because some of the characters are recurring.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I'm telling Leaf, play 999. The story will get so much better, and it will make so much more sense if you played the first game.
The final game is
okay.
The final game is said to be is said to have a great payoff for people who played the previous titles, because it answers a lot of questions that the series has. So it's the finale.
Yeah, we can't talk about what happens or explain why it's the finale. Because it would be a major spoiler. We cannot. No, you won't want to play the game anymore if we say why.
Okay.
Right?
I already played the last game then. Yeah. I don't say anything.
Don't say anything.
Yeah. That is good. What I like about this specific visual novel game is because it's like really watching an anime.
It is.
It's not just a plain image that you see, because you actually see them talking, you actually acting out. So it's a very interesting thing to watch while you're playing.
Plus
the puzzles are really good, so.
What's the game on the PS4, Leaf, that you made me play where the cheerleader was there? Butterflies. It was Thriller. It was a visual novel game.
And on PS4?
On the PS4, yeah. I remember screaming my head off in the office because the cheerleader was in a bathrobe and she was running and the killer was chasing after her.
Oh, it's not... Until Dawn.
That's the only one I remember.
What's the name? So Dawn?
Until Dawn.
Yeah. Until Dawn. Yeah, I think I can compare Virtue to Until Dawn.
Yeah. I agree. Right? It's kind of like... It's like playing. But you make choices.
It's like the 3D version of Virtue is Until Dawn.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Yeah, so if you liked Until Dawn, you have to play Virtue. it only makes sense that you do.
Did you ever finish Until Dawn?
No, because I got mad because the Chinese girl almost killed. I tried to save the Chinese girl, and then she bitched me, and the black guy died first. I was so angry, I walked away. It's all your fault. It's all your fault.
I still remember her name because I hate her so much. It was Emily.
Yeah. I wanted to kill her first.
But she survived in my game. Son of a.
I tried to help her.
Yeah, she survived.
She never dies. He never dies. The black guy died, and I was so sad. That's racist, I know.
Wait, was he the first guy? Was he the token?
Yes, he was the first guy. Oh, this is why he's so bad. Oh well. I'm not gonna play that game again.
did the new Virtua 999 game release already, or is it still coming?
I don't think they're gonna.
It's released.
Oh, it's released.
Is it?
What's the title?
It is.
Today?
Zero Time Dilemma.
Oh, Zero Time Dilemma. It's on PS4 and Vita.
PS Vita. PS Vita, 3DS, and PC.
Oh, not on the PS4.
That's what you meant by 999 game.
On PS4.
Zero Time Dilemma.
It's on PS4.
It's in space again.
Wait. I think it's bad if you actually release it for PS4 because the graphics aren't that great. They use the same whatever for the 999 and the Virtues. So if you port it to PS4, it'll look really shitty.
But so they released it on PC though.
Yeah,
because
PC would be compared to PS4.
The thing with PC is, even though it's a higher resolution, the monitors are smaller than the TV. So, even if it's...
I don't know.
It does not look that good. It's not highlighted sometimes. I'm not sure. I'm talking out of my
PC, though.
Mouth.
I'm not kidding. It's like, when you play old games, like Agarest.
Oh, wait, no. Was it 3D?
Like my... It's 2D, but they have this 3D effect to compensate for the 3DS because they're required to do it. Mm. 999 was just linear 2D. They used the same engine on Virtues, but then on Virtues, the 3DS was released, so they had to make it semi-3D, which didn't turn out very well. And now, the third one, I feel that still uses the same engine. They still have to make it semi-3D, which I think won't sit well with a PS4, but it's kind of okay with a PC. Mm. Like, I remember, what was that game on sale? I was going to say Fantasia, but there was an old game on the GameCube that I remember, Grandia, yes.
Oh, Grandia.
Grandia, yeah. That was
Grandia 2,
That was a direct port from the GameCube, and it still looked kind of okay on the PC. You can't port that to any other console.
Mm.
Yeah. That's okay. True.
So that's 999 PC's release. Next up is No Man's Sky. Finally passed CERT. For those of you who don't know, CERT is certification, and it's not a PC thing, it's consoles. So before they can ship the game, they have to pass a test from they have to be certified with Sony. So they send the game to Sony, and then they check it for bugs. It's technically QA. Mm. And then after that, they will either have a list of things they need to fix, if there's bugs here, bugs that, because usually multi-platform games, you tend to neglect some of the bugs because you're busy focusing on bugs in other systems. You might pass over some, so that's why certification is required for consoles most of the time. And they posted an image on Twitter saying they've been certified, it's gold, they can now ship the game. So no more delays.
Yay!
Yay!
we can finally own the planet.
Released?
It's they didn't change the release date. It's still August, I think.
Oh my god, really?
Okay.
No, because that's so the far. Same month. That's the same month that Pokemon is gonna get released and that game is gonna get released. How will I have the time?
I thought November was Pokemon.
Oh really? Okay. Yeah.
You said November.
Okay.
Yeah, Sun and Moon is in November.
November? Okay. That's fine.
That's
cool. I still have money. I still have money to play everything.
Okay.
Yeah, No Man's Sky.
Yeah, leave your we can hear it in your voice that you're very excited for this game.
Yes, I am.
But you know, that's always his reaction in real life.
That's why people won't know, but we do. We heard he was very excited.
Yeah. That's the level of excitement that Leaf has. That's how he feels every time. Like, oh my god, Leaf, I won the lottery!
I really am excited.
Yay, won the lottery.
Did you know one of the reasons why they were delayed? I'm not sure if it's the core reason, but it was one of the contributing factors. Sky, the company, Sky Cable here, is an international company. They did not want them using the word Sky. So, they were in legal just disputes. Come again?
Well,
are they just going to call it No Man's or
they settled the case finally. Oh, okay. And it was like a week after they announced that they were gonna delay the game, so it might have been a contributing factor to the August delay, a July delay technically.
I mean, don't companies always do that, like make these sort of things like super serious about names and stuff?
Yeah, it's really weird because they're now going after specific words. So do you know that Microsoft lost against Sky?
Because?
Microsoft lost against Sky. Do you know OneDrive? The cloud service? It was supposed to be SkyDrive.
Oh.
Sky was not. Because they had a better case.
It's so weird.
Because they had a better case because it's technically service. So
exactly, that makes sense. That
so they had a chance to
I'm trying to understand why Sky sued No Man's Sky, right? It's probably because it has a negative connotation, right? You're trying to sell a service and here comes this guy with his game saying No Man's Sky, no man will subscribe to your service. so that's probably why they don't want any negative thing going on in their name, because I want more people to know stuff about my network.
But in general, outside protecting their brand, trademarks are used to cash in on names. People sit on trademarks a lot.
Oh yeah, I know.
They can get royalties or get or settlement fees
money.
I think Sony helped. What's the game developer again? They made the biking game. No Man's Sky developer. Google.
I'm not sure. I don't remember.
Wait for a moment. Google.
Keep tabs on developers at all. I only like, hey, this game is pretty. What's its name? How I roll.
I only know Naughty Dog.
I want to say,
why would you know that, Leaf?
Because it's my favorite developer of all time.
It's Hello Games. They did the biking game before. It's a very drastic change from what they were making. I think something like Trials. Picture that. Dangerous Joe, I think the game was. And then they're doing this. Huge departure from what they're used to, but you need to take risks, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And
well, hopefully it's gonna be good for them when it gets released.
What do you expect?
I'm pretty sure it will. I'm pretty sure it will.
With all the, what do you expect the game is? How do you expect the game to be like, Leaf?
Well, I expect it to be a free roaming game about space. So, I feel like an explorer, mm-hmm. something. I don't know if there's gonna be fights though, but they did showcase fights in it, so I don't know how it will play out.
The game is really weird for me. I started out loving the concept, the idea of exploring space, but the more they mm-hmm. showed the game, the more I got off the hype train, because it just feels empty. I'm someone who cannot create my own narrative. When you put me in a sandbox, I get bored.
I think it's gonna be, so when the game gets released, I think there will be two kinds of players who will play that game. One are the typical RPG players who will make their own content, create their own stories, you know, really feel the game for how it's made. And the other side of the world are the players who are like, hey, I uncovered this some sort of thing. I'm posting it on the forums. Tell me what it means. And they're all going to, like, extract as much information and beat the game as quickly as they can and be like, ha, world first. So I think that's how I see the game will become. But, I mean, it's fine. That's how communities role when it comes to gaming anyway.
I would probably be an RPG player as long as the world is set. Like Ark, for instance, there was this RPG server where there was laws already. There were people who govern the world, and then you can't go beyond. People set limitations, and then mm-hmm. you had a role to fill, and you technically become the character. So I've tried to do that with a lot of games, but people don't follow. I remember trying to get you guys to play Hearthstone with me and play it like it was Yu-Gi-Oh.
The lead and the heart of the cards.
We couldn't do that because we weren't together in real life, remember? And you wanted to do it like in a video, and we're like, we don't have time, let's just play. But that was the reason why that didn't pan out really well, because mm-hmm. we weren't together in real life.
Also,
but,
I only had the mage deck, the starter.
That's true. But yeah, I think No Man's Sky is a great game. I think it's gonna be great. It only matters on who's looking at it and how you plan on playing it. Because mm-hmm. I think that they have this certain group of people. This certain group of people, like the way EVE Online players enjoy the game so much. And me, I'm afraid of playing it because I think it will, like, eat my life force. I'm trying to say.
It would be great to RP with a couple friends in No Man's Sky. The problem is, they've said from the very beginning that you might not get to see your friends ever.
And that's fine. That's fine.
Like, go out and make new friends.
Your end game goal is to actually find the friends you know in real life. That could be an end game goal. Like, for other people, it's getting the best armor. But for you, your end game goal is like be able to find my friends in this world.
The problem with that is that the game's goal is to get to the center of the universe. What if I start over here, at the center here, and leave it there? So, we technically finish the game before we can see each other.
Then,
after
you quote-unquote finish the game, that's not the real end game for you. Keep playing until you find your friend.
So that becomes the end game content. Find your friend.
Mm-hmm. Find your friend.
Find your friend.
That's a unique end game for you, right?
Find a friend in the universe.
I do want to see. I'm interested, not that much right now, but I want to see what else the game has, because it does have a lot of resource gathering parts. I want to know what those are for.
I love resource gathering.
Mm-hmm. Oh, Leaf!
I love resource gathering.
If you find some kind of cat-goat mixture in No Man's Sky, take a picture. show it to Mickey, and she'll buy the game instantly.
No. Let me just tell you. I found a goat in Fallout 3. I swear to God, I was so sad because its face was mutated.
There's a goat?
And I had to... There's a goat in Fallout 3. How could you have played it and not seen this goat? Because, unlike everybody else, what I leveled was not my gun. Or how do you call that? Perception?
Yeah, perception.
Ample gun fighting.
Uh-huh.
I leveled my melee. So I bring a machete everywhere.
Is that the shish kebab machete?
It's just the machete you get in the beginning of the game.
You should go to Megaton.
I have no idea where that is. Don't tell me about
it. Are you saying Fallout 3 or Fallout New Vegas?
New Vegas, I'm sorry. Fallout New Vegas.
No goat in Fallout 3.
I'm sorry. Okay, it's New Vegas. And so I leveled my survival only. So it's like, I level 2, my survival is level 45. All I do in the whole game is find stuff to cook.
Oh, you're on survival mode also, right? Where if you don't drink, you die.
I'm on hard mode. Yes. Uh-huh. Yeah. So now I'm addicted to vodka because it's the only drink I have. And I keep cooking because you need to cook in hardcore mode. And when I talk to NPCs, I don't look at guns. I sell all my guns. And the most difficult food I've ever had.
Difficult how? Difficult to cook or difficult to
It's difficult to craft because you craft food, right? It's the most difficult thing to create. I was like, this is the thing that keeps me alive. Why can't you give this to me, game? So it's... I've been trying so hard. So now, I got encumbered. Is that how you say it? Anyway.
Unencumbered.
Encumbered.
Encumbered. Yeah.
Encumbered. There. I got encumbered because I collect all the coffee mugs I find. And I couldn't move. I couldn't move anymore because I had so many coffee mugs. And yeah, that's how I've been playing the game so far. I haven't killed the goat yet. I have to kill the goat though because that type of goat has to be cooked for some reason. And I can't find it in me to kill the goat. But yeah. I haven't recorded myself, thank God. I deleted everything. So we'll see.
Just play the game, and then someone there will click record last 15 minutes on Shadowplay. You don't have to worry yourself about doing that. Yeah. We will do it.
Nope. So anyway, what else do we need to talk about?
So that was No Man's Sky. It's only me that's excited. I might buy it, to be honest. Because I actually love a lot of space stuff. No Man's Sky, you can't take this guy from me.
I know. I think it's a nice game to play with friends, though.
But you can't.
Because it's like... What I'm trying to say is it's not a great game to play together with, but it's like when you play it and then you talk to someone else.
I understand. The day after schoolyard talk. The
discovery
like,
stuff.
What did you find? Interesting.
Yeah, that is a good conversation starter.
And then it's like, you got this? I need that. Where? Yeah. Oh, over there. Okay.
Like when I talk to you about Fallout, I think that's how No Man's Sky is gonna be for everybody.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
because they'll have separate experiences.
I wonder if their generators will have redundancies because it's supposed to be a unique planet every time.
I'm pretty sure there will be. I'm not gonna expect much from it so that I don't get disappointed.
Okay,
it's probably gonna be how Guildverse 2 said every event is gonna be unique. What you do will be different, blah blah blah, with the game.
Yeah, that's how they pitched Guild Wars 2. I was sad when I was not able to buy it at day one, but when I played it, it's like, this is not what they told me.
Exactly. So I'm not gonna expect much so that I don't get disappointed. But if it really does happen, then that would be great.
Speaking of MMOs, there was an MMO that was going to be like No Man's Sky. It was called EverQuest Next. Not exactly, but the concept of you affecting the world permanently was a big thing for EverQuest Next, but sadly that game is no more.
No. Well.
Yep.
We live and learn.
So, that was No Man's Sky. The next big news is something that happened fairly recently. A couple days ago, for the anniversary of Evolve, the game, they had a timer on their website. Many people thought it was just to celebrate the new year and the new season, because they pitched it as seasonal, like, this season these are the contents you will get throughout the year. Next season you'll get, we'll release new stuff for you to buy. But apparently, season 2 is Evolve free to play. It's now called Evolve Stage 2, the game free to play. I've downloaded it, haven't tried it yet, but I did play it before. And a lot of people seem to be playing it now compared to when it was sold. Thoughts?
Leif, I have no thoughts about this game.
I think people are interested with the game though, but I think when it was released, a lot of other games came out that were better. So that's why the hype like died down. So I guess when they announced it free to play, so all those people that were interested before are now back again and interested with playing the game. So I think that's why.
What killed them honestly was their marketing team or the executive of the game, because it's a $60 game, but months before the game was released, they already were talking about DLC, and then the amount of DLC they had prepared before release was staggering. So it felt like the presentation felt like that of a free to play game, but it was worth $60.
That's true.
Entry. So I guess their marketing won because they kept their formula, except now that the entry fee of $60 is waived.
Yeah, plus it's a multiplayer game. It's not like Destiny where it's an RPG / multiplayer game.
Yeah,
I think that's also.
It's actually very. Actually made it free to play in a very interesting time, because right now, asynchronous multiplayer is very big. Asynchronous means the parties are not matched, so it's 3v2, in this case 4v1.
Oh my god!
Yeah, because the one is very imba. A lot of multiplayer games are coming out right now. Asynchronous multiplayer games. Friday the 13th is a Kickstarter thing that a lot of people are talking about. The new Dead by Daylight, is that the new one? A lot of dead games. Oh wait.
Dead by Daylight,
which is similar to Friday the 13th, except you have multiple stuffs. That's very big right now. And I can't name others, but the trend is going to asynchronous multiplayer, and all of those have a paywall, I think. Pretty sure they all have a paywall. And here comes one of the biggest budget asynchronous multiplayer game in recent history, and it just became free. So yeah, they situated themselves in a very, very good place.
Well, you know how I feel about multiplayer games, right? Like, I feel that when it comes to multiplayer games, you need to make sure that you will have a healthy number of people playing the game all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And we've discussed this at length in real life, but
a lot.
Yes, when you don't have enough players, your multiplayer game will obviously die. Mm-hmm. Which is why I'm a big fan of free to play and not pay to win games.
Mm-hmm.
But so, you know, the money gets in the way. But so what I'm trying to say is, this is a pretty good move for them. Mm-hmm. So I hope this game is not for me. Let's just be honest. Probably will. I'll try. I promise I'll try.
You can be the monster and go rar.
Okay, deal. but yeah, like if they did go this route, they could have seen themselves dead by now.
For people that don't know this game, Evolve is an asynchronous multiplayer game. I've said it already. It's 5v1 probably. And it's four hunters, four or five hunters versus one monster. The reason why it's called Evolve is because the monster evolved. You start off fairly weak. So your goal is to hunt the surrounding areas and try to improve yourself, become a bigger threat, evolve.
Mm-hmm.
And I think there are it's two evolutions, so third stage. And once you're in the third stage, you pretty much can kill.
That's Keigo, by the way.
Okay, Keigo. Can't hear me. So it's very tense because people are hunting you, and then so for the hunters, you really want to catch the monster real quick so that he won't become a threat, and you have to hide. If you're the monster, you have to hide, feed as much as possible, don't make too many noise, because everything you do as a monster can be tracked by them. Like if they have the person with a doggy, not really a doggy but technically a doggy, that doggy can follow your scent, so you have to move through the water to hide your scent, and then if you feed and disturb a nest, the birds will fly away. Which if people listen in enough or look up, they can see, oh, it's over there. Let's go check that area. I've enjoyed my time a lot with the demo. Okay, go.
So it's like playing
hide and seek.
No. What's the zombie game?
Left 4 Dead.
Yeah,
it's like playing Left 4 Dead.
PvP,
yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, cool.
Yeah, it's also like the PvP in Dying Light.
I haven't tried.
The Be the Monster thing.
Be the Monster, Dying Light.
I don't want
to. I haven't tried it yet.
Yeah. That's the mode, Be the Monster.
So, do you guys want to schedule a game session?
Or?
Evolve? Yeah.
Okay. Let's schedule that later. Okay. But yeah, we can do that. And invite a lot of people.
We're actually ahead of time. That was all the news topics we had prepared. We have about 12 minutes left. Mikki, you had a topic you wanted to talk about. Do you want to start that?
What was it? I don't know. Which one? Because I remember it a lot.
It was
The
fan.
Oh, yeah. So, what was the question? I don't remember the question.
Wait, let's see if we... It's in chat. I mean, FB chat, let's see.
Yeah. Something about a true fan. Are you a true fan?
Like, are you a true fan if you don't buy the merchandise?
Yes. So wait, there is a disclaimer about that whole topic though. So I don't become the evil guy here. Let us explain what the question was about.
Yeah, so, let's look for the question first.
Let's give a small background on background on why it actually popped in my head. So, in the way that we as a gamer slash consumer race, nerd race, whatever you call it, has evolved. Where you as the consumer can directly interact with like the content maker or the writer or the producer of whatever thing you're consuming. Are you still a true fan if you don't buy the merchandise? Is the question. So, Leaf, you answer first because you're the only one who has not
contributed to the
No, because Kokoy has already said his stuff on Facebook. Well, so Leaf has to explain his
For
stuff.
Me, I think there are two kinds of fans. For me, there's just two kinds of fans. The ones that buy the merchandise and the ones that talk about it. Even though they don't buy it. Because, I mean, technically, you can be a fan even without buying something. Mm-hmm. Like, for example, for Batman, you don't have to buy Batman merchandise to become a fan of Batman because you can access information about Batman basically on the internet. I don't think it's a requirement to buy the merchandise, but it's optional for me.
So all fans are true fans, is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah, the thing with this question, Leaf, is the modifier of true. Because,
I think everyone is a true fan.
Brief history of the phrase a true fan. It's used in our group as a insult. The phrase is, you're not a true fan. So, a lot of us in the group are very passionate about certain stuff. If we found out that he's not aware of a specific topic pertaining his obsession, then we call him out by saying you're not a true fan. And we have this one friend, you know him, he gets offended when we say he's not a true fan. So, outside the modifier, I have to say that being part of fandom is not really the amount of money you throw at the people is not really an indication of being part of the fandom, but you will feel left out when you're part of a fan and you can't buy a thing, because when you're at that level of commitment to a specific thing, you will want to. Me, I love Mass Effect. I want the N7 jacket so much. I can't buy it. It's not here. When I ordered it along with the Naughty Dog jacket, was there. Which was Leaf, by the way, but it was too big. Thank you, Leaf. When I ordered the N7 jacket together with Leaf, Naughty Dog 25th anniversary jacket, it was out of stock. So even if I was not able to buy the jacket, I would still consider myself a true fan.
Okay, so yeah. My turn.
I agree with that. Mm-hmm.
Okay, my thoughts about this whole true fan business. So we talked about this in the car, and we were looking at people who are Star Wars fans, right?
Yes.
So we've got people who are, I can say they are fans, and they would flaunt all their merchandise, and it looks so cool.
Yeah,
especially
it does.
That BB-8 thing that was very expensive.
It's,
yeah,
it's actually overpriced here by about 5,000.
Mm-hmm. The fact that they have it is like, whoa, that's so hardcore. Mm. But I think that in terms of how hardcore you are doesn't mean how much money you've put into something. So, whereas, let's say you have, I'm a fan of Melanie Martinez. She used to be in The Voice. It's that which reality TV show where singers go to and they sing.
I heard
and
the
she
voice.
Wasn't accepted. She, the voice, you know, oh, the show.
Okay.
And then eventually she made her own album. She became popular, and of course, since she's independent, I still bought her album, even if I don't have that much money to spend on merch stuff. Nor was I able to buy it immediately because certain country problems. But I still, you know, find ways to make sure that she gets her money's worth. So my whole view of this whole "you are not a true fan" business is I will always not be a true fan of big franchises like Star Wars, uh-huh, or D&D or what else? What's another? Or Marvel, right? Or
DC.
Batman. Or DC. Yeah, exactly. I will not be a true fan of those because I don't have that much money to spend. But I will spend, though, for people like Melanie Martinez, mm-hmm, who does things on her own. So I will be a true fan towards the independent people, but I cannot afford to be a true fan for the people who are already rich. Right? I'll just pirate their games.
Mm-hmm. So let's go off by from your definition. So supporting, right, is a factor in becoming a true fan. I supported Igarashi Koji in his game, mm-hmm, for $60.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a lot in our small little world, in our small little island. $50 is a lot.
But that was like about a year ago before I had problems.
I know, so, but still, that's still a lot of money. Still a lot of money. You can't find $60 anywhere.
Mm-hmm. So you would consider me a true fan, right?
Mm-hmm. In that definition, yes.
The thing is, I'm not really familiar with most of his work. I've only played like 3 prominent Castlevania games to completion. One which I can't seem to complete. It's a remake of the old NES games where there are lives. Like, there's no checkpoint. When you die, when you finish all your life, you go back to zero. So I'm trying, mm-hmm, to finish that one this week. I've been trying all week. I die a lot. But I wouldn't consider me a true fan, but by my definition, I'm not a true fan of Koji Igarashi, but I am a fan minus the true, mm-hmm, of his work, and mm-hmm, would love to see more.
Yeah, I guess the fact that you want to see more already makes you a true fan, right? Because that's why you throw money at it, because you want more of the same thing.
Okay. How about you, Leaf? Any examples?
Well, yeah, I mean,
okay,
you don't have to buy anything to be a true fan for me. You can support. You can support someone and be their fan and buy stuff to support them, but that doesn't mean you're not a true fan if you don't. Like, you can spread the word. You can ask people to support the person that you are a fan of, and let them buy for you. Then that's still being a supportive fan, right?
Yeah,
I would guess so. Right. The reason why Leaf is I'm this might not be true, but I'm gonna say something. Leaf is sort this topic brings shame, maybe, if that's the correct feeling to Leaf, because if we talk about spending for support, Leaf is a true fan of almost everything.
Well, I'm a true fan of collector's games. That's what.
Because he buys almost every collector edition that comes out.
Well, it's a hobby.
Yeah, he's a true fan of gaming.
Uh-huh. What?
See, in a general sense, uh-huh, we are all three of us are like true fans of gaming because we talk about it here right now.
Yeah.
But you have to have that specific one, and I know for a fact that Leaf loves Batman so much, right? I know for a fact that Leaf is a true fan of Batman. He has all those Batman shirts. Come on, how can you not? See, there's all Batman shirts. So, I don't know. that's, I don't know what other definitions there are in the real world, but we shall see.
So that's about it. It's now an hour and a half. So that's the Game to Change podcast. You can find us on our YouTube channels. For me, it'll be Veitsknight. For Leaf, it'll be Shadowdrake. And for Mikitchi, it would be Mickey. The problem with their YouTube channel is that when you search for theirs, a lot of other similar channels pop up. But if you click on my channel and go to my... I have a list of my friends on the side. Their channels will be featured there if you want to see what else they've been doing.
Oh, man.
Do you guys want to tell the people your Twitter account? If... No?
My Twitter is Mikitchi. I'm not certain if I'm absolutely active there. I'm more active on Facebook. Okay. And... if you are from Cebu and you're playing Pokemon Go,
no one in Cebu can play Pokemon Go. Lies.
When it comes out, it's probably gonna come out July 11th. So I will really suggest that you guys join the group so we can help each other out.
Okay, Leaf, where can we find you outside of your YouTube channel?
Just the YouTube channel.
Okay. I'm at Veitsknight on Twitter. It's very difficult to spell, especially it's right there on the video.
Just copy pasta.
Yeah, just copy pasta. And this is my channel, and we'll be here every week to talk about games. Just a reminder: the giveaway goes on for the entire month. It's $50 of something, mostly your choice. It's either Google Play. Google points, how do you call that? PSN codes,
eShop
codes, and is eShop in general
Steam
or
wallet.
Steam wallet, and probably Blizzard credits as well. So subscribe and comment to be eligible for that giveaway, and have a nice day. Bye.